I thought it would be interesting to include some of the scenes that were deleted in the DVD. The DVD is a medium that has the opportunity to have additional material. It isn't really appropriate for the movie, but are some of my favorite scenes and moments.
George may have had an idea for a scene at one time that for some reason didn't work out or wasn't completed. And it's fun to fish through those ideas sometimes and pick out the ones that that are favorites and bring them back and maybe modify them a bit and see if they can be fit into the scheme of things.
The whole process of editing is a process of paring the film down and keeping all the relevant material and getting rid of all the material that doesn't work for one reason or another.
It's like molding a piece of clay. When somebody's thrown you some clay, there's a parameter of the clay, but you need to start manipulating it to turn it into something.
Very often there are scenes that that were unimportant in the script but kind of came out great and have a lot of life to them that then will be an important part of the film, and then very important parts of the script that seem to fall flat or not work.
Long before previews, you know certain scenes should come out. They may repeat a point, they may not be performed as well, they may not add to the rhythms of the piece. And ultimately, I think film editing is about finding the rhythms of the story.
I always say, you know, it's not what you thought you shot, it's what you in fact shot, and try to proceed based on what you really have and where the life is and where the interest is rather than where you had hoped it was when you'd written the script.
Every director faces this at some point. You critique your film and you realize perhaps that you just can't put everything in it you want to because it will weaken the storyline rather than strengthen it.
When we did The Unbearable Lightness of Being, we had an incredible scene of the Russian invasion that I think ran about 13 minutes. Walter Murch and I cut together, and you know, Walter had done a marvelous job with it, and it worked great in itself. I mean, that was the centerpiece of the movie, essentially. But when we began to calibrate it with the rhythms of the movie, it sort of overwhelmed things, and I'd say we cut out almost half of that scene. It couldn't have been more painful to do because it all worked so well.
Once you get the film cut into one piece and you look at it, inevitably there are things that the director falls in love with that really, in the long run, don't have much to do with the story.
At a certain point in the evolution of the film, you have to stand back and say, what is there in this film that I like just because I'm me, that I have a personal attachment to, and what are the things in the film that are really essential for the film to tell its story?
And is it relevant to the story, or is it taking us off on a sidetrack that I may like very much, but which the audience probably wouldn't be interested in?
I had an interesting experience on Fred Zinnemann's Julia. We had completed the film. It had gone through all of the polishing in the editing room, but now we were ready to take it out and show it to an audience at a preview. Something happened in the preview, which was the audience was confused in the first 10 minutes because the structure of the screenplay was a flashback within a flashback within a flashback within a flashback. After the preview, I talked to Fred, and we came to the conclusion that the third scene in this sequence, probably we should try it out. However, as I was undoing the splice, taking this scene out of the film, Fred was sitting watching me do it, and he said, you know, when I read this script for the first time and I came to this scene, I knew that I could make this film. I stopped and I thought, oh no, are we now going to be ripping the heart out of this film? Something in a mysterious way that connected the director with the material. And I looked at him as if to say, well, I think we should do it. And he said, yeah, go ahead, do it. Now you come to the point of pulling this scene out. And even though you have decided to do it, there are many mixed emotions about it.
After the film's out and it's settled in and it's been a year or two since it was released, sometimes ideas keep coming back to you and you say, well, what would the film really be like if we put some of those scenes in it now?
In the case of Phantom Menace, we knew there were some very good ideas that never really made it into the movie. But we finished episode one about 3 weeks before the film was released. And we had about a week to enjoy the whole after release and the craziness of the picture opening. But immediately afterwards, we actually started working on episode two. We just didn't have the time to actually sit back and think of what we were going to do with the DVD. It was always George's intention to do something different. But I'll never forget, he called me up and he said, what if we actually completed all the sequences that we had to cut out of the movie? And it was such a bold and outrageous and wacky idea. But it wasn't just like simply hitting a button and making it happen. We had to, you know, set up a crew, finish all the conceptual artwork, finish the animatics of the things that we had stopped midway. And that was like making a movie.
One of the problems with episode one is that by the very nature of the film, we have to sort of assemble the shots before we're able to cut them together. Once we've cut them together and we've done some little videomatics, we try to get a sense of whether the film is working or not with very little of the film there. But inevitably, in a film like Phantom Menace, we're faced with the overall length issue. The film can't be too long.
One of the concerns you have in releasing a feature film is the running time. And George Lucas has always preferred to have a film that was about 2 hours in length.
You have to look at the film as a whole when you've cut it all together and see where it's slow, where it's not playing well.
Any shot, any sequence that gets in the way of the story has to be cut out. And actually, I've never seen anybody who's more ruthless with his own work than George.
Because of the success of the movie and because it's a DVD, we were able to finish off these scenes and see what they would have looked like had I left them in the movie.